Good morning. Welcome to Emmanuel Southern Baptist. If y'all could make it to your seats, we'll get started.
Well, blue skies and hillsides feel so far away. And I wrote in my notebook that I've seen better days than the ones as of late. I can't bear the weight. The rain won't stop pouring out my window pane. And I haven't left my bedroom in 76 days. I wish something would change. 'Cause I'm losing faith. So I wrote it up. Bit of desperate prayer. Lord, why are you keeping me here? Then he said to me, child, I'm planting seeds. I'm a good God and I have a good plan. So trust that I'm holding a watering can. And someday you'll see the flowers grow. So whatever the reason, I'm barely getting by. I'll trust it's a season, knowing that you're by my side every step of the way. And I'll be okay, 'cause I wrote it up in a desperate prayer. Lord, why are you keeping me here? Then he said to me, child, I'm planting seeds. I'm a good God and I have a good plan. So trust that I'm holding a watering can. And someday you'll see the flowers grow in the valley. Looking down below, I'll see a valley of flowers that needed time to grow. And I'll thank you for the rain, the hurt and days of pain. And I'll bring it up in a grateful prayer. Thank you, Jesus, for keeping me there. You know just what I need. And you planted seeds. 'Cause you're a good God with a real good plan. And you hold my world in a watering can. So I can have peace. 'Cause flowers grow in the valley.
Good morning, everyone. You make your way back to your seats, but please remain standing for our first song on this beautiful fall morning. And we're going to start off with He Set Me Free. So it's a beautiful day to sing such a beautiful song. I think it went up. Hang on. Hang on a second. I think somebody's.
Well, this is a clapping song.
I can't sing. I can't see what I'm doing.
You want it?
Try this. See if that'll work. Otherwise, all I see is black, and I can't see the notes.
Don't be afraid to clap.
Once like a bird in prison I dwell, no freedom from my sorrow I found. But Jesus came and listened to me, and glory to God, He set me free. He set me free, oh, He set me free. darkness of night had drifted away. My feet are planted on higher ground, and glory to God, I'm homeward bound. He set me free, oh, He set me free. He broke the bonds of prison for me. I'm glory bound, my Jesus, to see. For glory to God, He set me free. Goodbye to sin and things that confound. Not of this world shall turn me around. Daily I'm working, I'm praying too, and glory to God I'm going through. He set me free, yes, He set me free. He broke the bonds of prison for me. I'm glory bound, my Jesus, to see. For glory to God, He set me free.
You may be seated. Everybody's looking at me and tell me I played it too fast.
No, we miss Amanda's alto.
My fingers have a tendency to just speed everything up. All right. Oh, say, but I'm glad. I hope you're all glad today. I hope you have a song in your heart. That's what this song talks about. Having a song in your heart because of Jesus. There is a song in my heart today, something I never had. Jesus has taken my sins away. Oh, say, but I'm glad. Wonderful, marvelous love He brings into a heart that's sad. Through darkest tunnel my soul just sings, oh, say, but I'm glad. Oh, say, but I'm glad, I'm glad. Oh, say, but I'm glad. Jesus has come and my cup's overrun. Oh, say, but I'm glad. We have a fellowship rich and sweet, tongue can never relate. Living in Him is a blessed treat. Oh, say, but I'm glad. Oh, say, but I'm glad, I'm glad. Oh, say, but I'm glad. Jesus has come and my cup's overrun. Oh, say, but I'm glad. Won't you come to Him with all your care, weary and worn and sad? You too will sing as His love you share. Oh, say, but I'm glad. Oh, say, but I'm glad, I'm glad. Oh, say, but I'm glad. Jesus has come and my cup's overrun. Oh, say, but I'm glad. And in those times, maybe you don't feel so glad, you just hold to God's unchanging hand.
Time is filled with swift transition. Not of earth and moon can stand. Build your hopes on things eternal. Hold to God's unchanging hand. Hold to God's unchanging hand. Changing hand. Trust in
unchanging hand. Unchanging hand. Covet not this world's vain riches that so rapidly decay. Seek to gain the heavenly treasures, they will never pass away. Unchanging hand. Hold on to God's unchanging hand. Build your hopes on things eternal. Hold to God's unchanging hand. When your journey is completed, if to God you have been true, the home eternity, you're enraptured, so will you. Hold to God's unchanging hand. Hold on to God's unchanging hand. Build your hopes on things eternal. Hold to God's unchanging hand.
Emmanuel means God with us, at church and school, at home, at play. We can find God in everything. Don't believe me? Watch this.
Good morning, guys. It's a beautiful day out there. I've got a, looks like just a little wooden box, but you know what you used to use these for all the time? This was a keepsakes box. And you'd put all your keepsakes in it. You get a memory, something that you did, and you put that piece of paper in there, and you got a little note from somebody, you'd put that in there. You get a present from Vacation Bible School, and you'd put that in there. And you'd fill this all up with all things that you just wanted to remember. This one here, it's empty. And you know, it's not because we don't have a lot of memories, but it's kind of the idea, you know, the Bible says that we have a lot of things that we've done that maybe we don't want to remember, but they're still there. And they would fill up this box many times over. But the Bible tells us that God has taken them and put them far as the east is from the west. You know how far that is? Well, seeing how the east is on that side and the west is over there, somewhere way off over there and somewhere way off over there, they're never going to get together, because if they get over here, well, it still moves. So the east and the west are never going to get together. And so God is saying all those memories of things that we shouldn't have done, or things that we said that, oh, I wish I hadn't said that. But guess what? God says, I'm not going to remember them. I'm going to put them way away. They're not going to be in that box that you have to worry about me remembering them. So it's good to have memories and have some place to put them, the little keepsakes. But just remember that if we ask Jesus to forgive us, we ask Him to come into our hearts. He takes all those bad memories, all those things that we've done, and He puts them away. That's neat. Let's fold our hands and close our eyes. Jesus, thank you for all the neat things that happened to us, the nice memories that we have. And thank you especially that if we ask you in, you'll forgive us and take those away, those bad things we've done. Be with our moms and dads as they try to teach us about your love, and especially our pastor, Lord, as he teaches us too. These little ones we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
So here's your challenge for the week. Search for God in everything. You'll be amazed where you'll find him.
Thus, as we sing our praise chorus, please. How great is our God?
The splendor of the King, all in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, let all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, it trembles at his voice. It trembles at his voice. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all will see how great, how great is our God. Age to age he stands.
Praise team has a little special for you, and if you all want to sing along, you can.
Now, this was a spur of the moment thing, so, but it's one that you all should know, so you can just sing with us.
Oh, they'll do good.
You know, I saw the light, don't you?
I wandered so aimless, I filled with sin. I wouldn't let my dear Savior in. Then Jesus came like a stranger in the night. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more in darkness, no more in night. Now I'm so happy. Sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. Just like a blind man, I wandered along. Worries and fears I claimed for my own. Then like the blind man, the God gave back his sight. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light. I saw the light. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. wander and stray. Straight is the gate and narrow the way. Now I have traded the wrong for the right. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more a darkness, no more a night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light.
Turn with me to Nehemiah chapter 2. He put that up there in big letters for me. Talked a couple of weeks ago, and it kind of got interrupted in all the different things we've been doing, but started talking, and we talked about walls, and Nehemiah's, the entire book is about building walls and tearing walls down. What is it that we put up? And today, we're going to talk about chapter 2. We're going to discuss the walls we put up between us and God. Oh boy, that's tough, ain't it? Everybody just look down at their Bible and think, well, I'm glad I can see that. We put up walls in our lives that God doesn't want us to have in the middle. Ain't no telling what I'm preaching on. Once I put the glasses on, ain't telling what it says. I'm going to start out here and just look back just a little bit, but what he's done so far is Nehemiah's got something on his heart. Anybody ever get something on your heart but you don't know what to do with it next? Okay, Nehemiah, the end of chapter 1, and when you begin chapter 2, you see the fact that he prays. He goes to God with what's on his heart. Lord, this is on my heart. Did God already know what was on his heart? Absolutely, but God wants you to come before him and say, this is on my heart, I got to get this fixed. What do I do about this? Whether it's good, bad, or indifferent, God wants you to come and ask, what do I do? Now, what he does here is he goes before God, but then he does the part that most everybody messes up, including me. Okay? I want to start out with chapter 2, verse 1, and I want you to see what it is we mess up so often. It says, and it came to pass in the month of Nisan, in the 20th year of Artaxerxes, the king, that was wine before him. Now, 4 months later. That's really what that verse just said. You got to go back and it's the difference in this and this. But 4 months later. So he had something on his heart. He went before God and he thought he got an answer. But then he had to stop and say, God, you better fix it. Because I can't do what you're saying. How many of us have ever been called to do something and know we can't do it? How many of us woke up this morning? Everybody drove, so I'm assuming, you know, one time I drove to Springfield. I was going to class all the time, and I drove to Springfield one morning for class, and I woke up in class. I'm just saying, it sounds like somebody needs to wake up. It's time to wake up here. How many of us have ever had something on our heart and we want to fix it, but we don't know how? And when we pray about it, we don't wait on God because we can't fix it. How many problems in my life have I got no chance to fix? A lot of them. But God works things out. You know what's really great? Patience. Oh no, the preacher ain't going to start on that. That's part of what to start here. I promise I'll move on. But as you get older, hopefully, now some people don't, I will say, but as you get older, you're supposed to learn to be patient, to realize that if you just keep your mouth shut every once in a while, you let God work, and then all at once, things work out. You got to step in and help, but God works things out. He's really good. He wants your help, but He doesn't want you to take over. Anybody ever try to work with their wife or husband? Anybody ever try to work with their spouse? How long does it take before they take over? And then you say something, and then you have to take over. And then they say something, and they have to. And there's never a work together. Charlotte and I did not work together building a house. She came in on Fridays, looked, and said, I want this, and this, and this, and this. And I said, see you next Friday. Now, we were together all the time, but Monday through Friday, I worked on the house. And she would come in and say, I need this and this and this and this. No problem. See you next Friday. No, you don't work together. It doesn't always work. Some people here can. I applaud you. I was just smart enough to know we couldn't do that. Because she was going to take over. And then I was going to get mad, and then she was going to let me take back over, and I was going to be stuck. God wants to tell you how to do things. How many of us don't listen? Oh, boy. Come on. Nehemiah's not that guy. Nehemiah waits 4 months. He's praying. He's waiting on. He knows he's going to have to do something here, but here he goes. So he was in charge of the wine, and he was in charge of the bread. He went before the king. And at this point in time, the person that's in charge of that food, you know what happened to a lot of these kings? They got poisoned. And the person in charge of that wine is as important as anybody in that place. So after 4 months now, he doesn't go around much. It doesn't say where the king was or if the king just wasn't a drinker or what. But it says he took up the wine and he gave it to the king. And he said, now I had not been before time sad in his presence. Now, if somebody is king and they're dependent on you to make sure they don't get poisoned, and you go before them and you're sad, that may be a red flag, right? Wherefore the king said unto me, why is thy countenance sad, seeing thou art not sick? This is nothing else but sorrow of heart. Then I was very sore afraid. Now all at once it's, oh man, he sees there's something on my heart and he's going to think I'm trying to kill him. What's going to happen to Nehemiah? His head's coming off. Somebody else can bring the wine. Somebody's got a smile on their face. Oh, now, you ever been around people and they act sad all the time? After a while you're thinking it's because of you? Okay. And he said unto the king, let the king live forever. Boy, I like that. Oh, you can live forever. Praise the Lord. I mean, you can see what he was doing. Immediately, he answers the king. He says, let the king live forever. Man, I'll sip on that wine. Don't worry about it. I'm not trying to poison you. It's really what he was saying. Why should not my countenance be sad when the city and the place of my father's sepulchres lies in waste and the gates thereof are consumed with fire? He said, what I'm sad about is something a long way from here. And it's on my heart. When God lays something on your heart, folks, it's okay to be sad about it. We should be sad about our country right now. I'm just, jumping off on my own boat there, and that's not what my sermon's about, but we should be sad about the spot our country's in. When we've got to run ads on television saying that we're not for transgender people playing ball, boys and girls, when you got to start talking about boys and girls having sex change operations when they're kids, when you got to start talking about taxes that go to prisoners to have an operation, there's something crazy about that. We hadn't ought to have that argument. That ought to just be common sense, and our country's not eat up with common sense. There's some things that's just on our hearts, and we should be sad about that. But that sadness shouldn't come out in our expressions. It should come out in our prayers. Lord, be with us. Help us, Lord. What are we going to do? We've got to make decisions. So you go on there and it says, and then the king said to Nehemiah, for what dost thou make a request? Oh boy, that's what he's been waiting on. He didn't really know what he was waiting on, but he knew he was waiting on God to open up the door. And the king said, so what are you asking of me? See, that's this king, I like this king. Because when people come to me with stuff, I'll say, well, what can I do about it? The king likes Nehemiah. He got nothing against him. I mean, he's been a loyal servant. And the king, well, what are you asking? Just ask. Have you ever thought that God wants you to just go ahead and ask for what's in your heart? Now, in the next little bit here, we're going to try to take the king and show you how you deal with God, but don't build walls. Don't be sad all the time around him, because guess who's in charge? God's in charge. What is it that would make you sad? Luke chapter 23, I believe it is, 24 maybe, on the road to Emmaus. And Jesus is walking beside him and he says, why are you walking along so sad? And I said, have you not heard about all that's went on? And he said, no, what's went on? Have you ever thought about the fact that Jesus died for your sins? Where are we headed? Our country may be headed down the toilet. Okay? It may be. But at the end of the day, where am I headed? I'm headed to heaven. Amen. I'm a citizen of another country. I'm proud of this one, and I do my best for this one. But at the end of the day, why would I be sad? Because I'm going to end up in heaven. Amen. If you're here and you know Jesus Christ is Savior, why would you be sad about all the nonsense here? Our job is to see what we can do to help. Our job is to fix what we can fix. Look around and see what God's got. But we build walls between us and God because we want to do things our way. I'm going to do it this way. Well, that won't work. And I'm going to do it this way. But that don't work. Now, I'm going to be polite how I say this. And if I'm going to be polite, I better keep reading. He said, and I said to the king, if it please the king, if thy servant has found favor in thy sight, that thou wouldest send me to Judah. Send me where I need to go. How many of us have ever said that to God? Where do I need to go? Where do I need to be part of? Where do they need my help? Where can I help? Boy, what is it that 60-something years ago, John Kennedy was famous for saying, don't ask what your country can do for you. Ask what you can do for your country. Wouldn't it be great if we did that with God? Amen. What can you do for God? Now, let me assure you, there ain't a whole lot God needs from me. But He needs me to be wherever He wants me to be at the time. He uses us in spite of us. So you go on there and it says, that's really what he's saying is, if I found favor, let me go where I need to go to help. I'm going to jump all the way down there to verse 7. How about that? Verse 7 says, moreover, I said unto the king, if it please the king, let letters be given to me to the governors beyond the river that they may convey me over till I come there. I'm going to be going through places that are dangerous. And if I ain't got somebody, if I ain't got a letter saying it's okay, I'm going to tell you, I got a letter to get through this world. And no matter what happens, I'm still safe. That's the way this works. He gives us this so we can get through. It's a map. You're going to go through this country. We're going to go through this world whether we like it or not. But at the end of the day, you use this and it gets you through. Now, let me keep reading here. I'm going to say, how am I going to put this? Let me keep reading. And a letter unto Asaph, the keeper of the king's forest, that he may give me timber to make beams for the gates of the palace. He was going to go build the gates and build the walls, and he didn't have no timber. And how much timber is around Jerusalem? None. Now he's going to go somewhere and build some, but he didn't even have anything to do it with. Do you realize that God called me to be a pastor, and I got no skills in pastoring whatsoever? Zero. What was really funny is I remember Wayne Hayes. Charles, you remember him real well. I remember I said something about going to seminary, and I was just a young man, and he said, well, he said, I'll tell you this, they ain't going to teach you a thing about preaching. And I said, okay. And he said, but you better go. And I said, okay. And he said, because you can't, it ain't like a chainsaw. That's what he said. It ain't like a chainsaw. You can't take hold of it and just make it go the direction you want it to go. You can't just overpower things. You got to learn how to deal with people. Now, I think Wayne should have took some of his own advice at times, but bless his heart, he always treated me good. And I took his advice. I'm like, well, everybody, you can't make people do things. You can preach the Bible the same way, and if people like it, that's great, and if they don't, that's great. But at the end of the day, how many people have been against me? I don't really know and don't really care. I've had a lot of people that I say came against me through the years. I ran into this or I ran into that. Sometimes I knew what to do and sometimes I didn't. But as long as you're, this is what it says, as long as you're here in your Bible, then God takes care of you. So he gives him a letter, and the letter says, you cut his timber for him. Do you realize that God goes ahead of us when he tells us to do something? And there's people there working to help us. I believe that with all my heart. I don't believe there's any place I've ever been that when I got there, there were not people already there working. That God had already been working. The Holy Spirit had already been dealing so that I could come in and do what little I do. How do you work with somebody that doesn't want to be worked with? Okay. How does God deal with us if we don't want to do things His way? You ever see the old donut commercials? Where the alarm goes off and the guy jumps up and says it's time to make the donuts. I need to get me one of them alarms. So that way it'll be, it's time for service. Okay, whatever. Okay, I'm going to jump on down to verse 10 now because he got all this stuff. He's given him these letters. In verse 10 it says, and when Sanballat, now here you go, somebody that don't like what you're doing because they got their own agenda. That's hard, ain't it? Ain't it hard to deal with people when they got their own agenda? Sanballat here, he has his own agenda, and that's the whole rest of the book, actually. And Sanballat, the Horonite, and Tobiah, the servant, the Ammonite, heard of it. Now, they don't want this stuff rebuilt because they're making money off of it. They got things going round and round. They're business people, and you start building a city, and you start bringing in stuff, and it's just going to be a problem for them. They don't want the king and all his buddies back. They want to just send their taxes and keep everything else. So they got their little scam going on. Could that be a little bit like our government today? See, our government today works like that, doesn't it? Isn't it funny how people... I say this all the time, and it's just common sense. But nobody seems to notice it. We have people who take a job, spend millions to be elected to a job that pays $100,000 a year, and 5 or 6 years later, they got multi-millions. Now, I don't know about everybody else, but that don't add up. I have been a terrible judge of money in my life, apparently. I ain't never had any of that stuff, and I still got nothing. What is it? Larry Gatewood told me one time that my wife and I had absolutely nothing when we got married, and we still got most of it. That's me, folks. I still got most of nothing. But how does that happen? See, that's Sanballat right here. Sanballat's one of them guys that he went up and he's got him a scam going on and he don't want nobody messing with it. Okay, now let me keep reading. It says, they heard of it, they grieved them exceeding that there was come a man to seek the welfare of the children of Israel. They're taking advantage of people. Why would they want somebody to come and take care of those folks? I got me a little note somewhere along the line there. It says, some will not like you following God's plan because they have their own plan. Isn't that odd? People get their own plan and then all at once God's plan don't mean much to them, does it? We build up walls between us and God because we have our own plan. God's over here and he says, here's what I want you to do. Well, yeah, I can do that, but I'll do it this way. This would work out much better for me, Lord. And then I hear this, and I hope nobody here has ever said that, but here's what I hear. Well, yeah, but the Lord still loves me. Just do what you want to, apparently. Now, here's the deal with doing what you want to. I had a pretty easygoing life. When I was growing up, we didn't have a lot of rules. We pretty much just ran wild banshees. I mean, but when it come time to work, you had to be there to work. That was it. I mean, if you'll work, hey, we got it made. I didn't have any kind of curfew, nothing like that. Whenever I was a kid, I just wandered the streets of Pomona. There's probably stuff got tore up around here because of me. I don't know for sure, but I wouldn't deny it if I was accused. We just wandered. Boy, when it was time to do some work, you better be ready to go work. So, there's different ways of handling things. See, what God says is, yeah, go ahead and do what you want, but there's work to be done. He doesn't mean if you want to. Has God called you to do something in your life? Has God called you to work within what's around you, and you're just not going to do it? I'm going to tell you, at the end of the day, you're going to wish you did. That's all there is to it. I remember being old enough to get in trouble, I guess. My future brother-in-law, Kent Johnston, he was a couple years ahead of me in school, and he got his driver's license. So he's 16, I'm 13 or 14. Me and him just left. I mean, we'd wander all night long. First night I stayed out all night long, come back into the house, not a word was said. I mean, I'm 13, 14 years old. I wandered in, crashed out on the couch. About 20 minutes later, my dad picked me up, set me up on my feet, and he said, time to go to woods. Boy, I just don't feel like that today. He said, oh, well, I ain't felt like that a lot of days, but I'm going, and you're going with me. Well, he walked out. I laid back down. He come back in. He picked me back up, and he said, two choices. I'm going to quote him almost word for word. You get in the truck, or I whoop you, and then you get in the truck. Totally up to you. Have you ever thought that that's how God's got to deal with us when we just won't do anything for Him? He's got to say, listen, this has got to be done. We have a world that's lost and dying and going to hell. And what do? That's my question. Have we built these walls up between us and God because we don't want His instruction? Do we have our own plan? What's God's plan for you? See, the funny thing is, I can't tell you. Because I'm not the Holy Spirit. Everybody spends their time waiting on the pastor to give them information. I done told you. Let me just end with this. How about that? I'm going to jump ahead here just a little bit. All the way to verse 20. Now, it's an interesting story. The whole story really is. There's times where it starts naming people and you kind of get lost in the names, but there's a reason for that, and it ain't got anything to do with me, but I can tell you if you ever want to know why all them names are there, but it's nothing to do with this sermon. Verse 20 there, it says, and then answered I to them, because they had come and they want him to do their thing. Here, do this with us. It says, then answered I unto them, the God of heaven will prosper us. Therefore we, his servants, will arise and build. But you have no portion, nor right, nor memorial. What is it? Because people who don't have part in God's plan, how are they going to know God's plan? How many churches spend their time wondering about what the world thinks of what they're doing? That makes no sense. They ain't got no part in it. Now, once you become part of the family, you have a part in it. All of us have to play our part. Whatever that part is. I guess I've got a big mouth. God says that I can take that mouth, and if I can ever tame it just a little bit. Amen? You know, the old saying about the wild horses. You know, you don't want a dead mule. You'd rather have something a little bit wild that you can tame. But so God decided if He could take my mouth and tame it just a little, that He could use it. Now, rest assured, He's still trying to tame it. But He wants to use what you have. What He's given you, He will use it. But you got to say yes. And at the end of the day, arise and build. What is it He's asking you to do? You're building something. I guarantee it. Every person on this planet is building something. Some of us are just building walls between us and God because we don't like what God has to say. We want to do things our way. Arise and build. That's what Nehemiah says, the most famous words. I got something in this. I got skin in the game. I'm part of this. If you're part of God's plan, arise. Find your spot and go to working. It's amazing what we do when we work together. It's amazing how much can be done when people work together. It's also amazing how fast you can build walls and just do nothing. That's quick. I'm going to ask the musicians to come forward. Coming to the end here, if you're here and you don't know God, if you don't know the Lord Jesus as your Savior, where's your instruction coming from? I'm talking about something that you don't have a part in. Not because you're not welcome, not because it's not there for you, just because you haven't chose to have a part in it. If you're here and you know Him as Savior and you don't know what your part is, you don't know what the plan is for you, it's because you haven't asked. You ask and you ask and you wait. That's all Nehemiah did. This is on my heart. Lord, help me with it. And then he waited. Maybe we're waiting. I don't know. If you're here and you don't know Him as Savior, that's where the plan starts. His plan is to save your soul. That's the bigger picture, isn't it? But then once you're saved, you become part of the plan to see others changed. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Lord, come to you right now, and I just ask if there's any here that don't know you as Savior, that they realize you have a plan for their lives and it starts with salvation. And we know where it ends. It ends with a home in heaven. But Lord, for those of us who do know that we're saved, for those of us who do know there's a home in heaven, Lord, help us to see what the plan is. What are we supposed to arise and build? What are we supposed to work on here? Where's our place in your plan? Lord, help us to see that you do have a place for each one of us. In Jesus' name we pray. Let's all stand.
Wherever He leads, I'll go. 285.
Take up. Follow.